How are you seeing the adoption of technology, or lack thereof, in your biotech industry right now?
Yeah. Good morning, and thanks for having me. As quick context, we started Benchling a decade ago to bring modern software to cutting-edge science. Today, our R&D cloud is used by more than 1,200 companies globally, small and large, so think household names like Gilead and Sanofi, to capture and structure their scientific data, often for machine learning, but broadly in service of bringing cutting-edge, life-changing products to people faster. I actually just got back from BenchTalk, our annual customer conference in Boston, where I spoke with hundreds of scientists who are working on everything from gene editing cures to heart disease, to personalized cancer vaccines, to treatments to slow the progression of Alzheimer's. So needless to say, it's a very exciting time to be in science.
Now, how much has information sharing been a blocker, Sajith? How much is what you're offering going to change the game or not? Because for many, you would feel that that collaboration, that sharing of information is already occurring within the labs.
Yeah. To state the obvious, science is incredibly complex and difficult. And anecdotally at Benchling, we've known some of the challenges posed by technology for progress in the sciences. You know, you have paper notebooks and spreadsheets and really old homegrown and legacy technology that makes it hard to collaborate. But my inner scientists always wanted more primary data to really quantify the progress the industry has made and to understand how much work there is in front of us to do. So this summer, we spoke with hundreds of scientists, R&D leaders, and IT executives, and produced the first State of Tech in Biopharma report. The headline, Carolyn, is that this is an industry that hasn't really seen the benefits of digital transformation yet, but it's one of the industries that needs it the most. If I dive into the data, the first thing scientists told us is that there's actually too much software. And I hope you see the irony of me, a CEO of a software company, saying that there's too much technology. But scientists, on average, have to use more than 5 highly specialized scientific applications per day to do their job. And these applications aren't the same throughout the entire organization. Some of the IT executives we spoke to have to manage an environment with hundreds of different tools that actually don't talk to one another. Only 28% of organizations feel like that data generated is actually interoperable. And that's a big problem when 84% of organizations project that their data is actually going to double in the next 12 months. So zooming out, this is an industry that's funding tens of billions of dollars in R&D outside of clinical trials, and most of that knowledge ends up trapped in silos.
So, G, you talked about technology for progress. I would say that the vast majority of conversations that Caroline and I have about AI in the healthcare, or more specifically, biotech, biopharma use case, is how it expedites drug development or gene therapy development. How does your research reflect that that's the area of most focus right now?
Yeah, we found that about 60% of organizations are testing the waters with machine learning and AI. And I think that's very much a bright spot. But there is skepticism as to the near-term impact that it's going to have. We really see two major challenges that are holding the industry back from realizing the full potential of AI and ML. The first is a talent gap. You know, being best in class here requires some of the brightest minds in science, but also some of the brightest minds from technology, data science, and machine learning. And historically, these are two industries that actually haven't mixed that much and have very different cultures. The other major challenge we see is in having purpose-built tools that actually advance the science, and that's where we're spending our time investing.
I've met so many highly qualified people, PhDs, working in this field, who complain that a lot of their time in the lab is spent pipetting something from one stage to the next. But it raises questions about automation, and that seems to be an area in more near term where machine learning in conjunction with hardware can be really helpful.
Yeah, we actually just launched a new product in support of that at BenchTalk, our customer conference. Majority of scientific experimentation involves instruments, and that's where vast majority of the data generation is happening. And so we've been focusing some of our investments on automating the flow of data out of instruments and into systems like Benchling for automated data analysis and capture in support of machine learning.